Well, it's good to have Robin with us tonight. And do you want the handheld or you want the handheld? Okay, dear. Come on. Yeah, you can come on up. Well, you got what? Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Come up here. Irene, come up here.
Here comes Irene.
Which one?
The right one.
That one over there?
Yes.
Put your hand on that knee. Okay? Father, in the powerful name of Jesus, I declare healing to this, Father. God, no tears, no bad reports, no anything. I declare healing, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Am I going to introduce you? Do we all know Robin? Huh? Okay.
That's good. That's good. He's so good. Not well, Pastor Dale's good too, but Jesus is great. You know, I love to say that. Thank you. I was amazed this time last year. I was sitting here thinking about, where was I this time last year? Since I've seen you all, I don't think I've seen you all for 2 or 3 years, have I? A little over a year. I've been around the world and back again. You could say I'm that movie, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, you know? And I was sitting there thinking, the sovereignty of God, one thing that people don't realize, I was here and I was thinking, God, there's people in this house that they've missed it. They've left. And they should be here. And God started speaking to me that the people that come, even in the days of, you know, the 1800s and when they hit San Francisco and went for the gold mines and started rushing for the gold mines, trying to find the gold. And there were those that they were panning for the gold, but they didn't stay around long enough to see what God was getting ready to bring forth. And I don't know anything. I just know the Lord's saying that there are nuggets, there's things, there's gold. The glory is the gold. The glory is the kabod. It's the weight of his anointing. And there's things that when you start going through the fires, when you start going through the wars, when the enemy comes to attack you, get ready. Something's getting, the Lion of Judah is going to roar like you've never seen him roar. And I believe that's what's happening in this church, that I don't know nothing what's happened here. I just know, I feel in my spirit, I sat there and I said, God, the people that came in and they were hungry for you, but they lost their first love and they lost the hunger of what it was to stand and wait for the glory of the Lord to come and do a work in them. And what I found out as I've traveled all over the nations and that the Lord has spoken to me, there's times it doesn't matter who you are, and Pastor Dale will tell you that when you're walking through the valleys, and you don't know what to do, that, well, you know what you need to do? You don't wait for somebody to come fix it. Jesus didn't say to the crippled man at the pool of Bethesda, you know, wait for the next time around. Wait for the next angel. He said something very distinct to him. He said, do you want to be made whole? And then he said the second thing. He said, well, take up thy bed. You've got to pick yourself up. And you got to step out on the waters and believe God for the anointing that he's placed on your life. When Paul was imprisoned, he wasn't in a place of, oh, I'm sorry for myself, I'm in prison. The Bible says that he wrote some of the greatest epistles out of that prison. He picked his spirit up. You got to keep your spirit, man, stirred up. He didn't wait for Timothy to come by. He didn't wait for some other of the apostles. He had it within him. Every one of you are carriers of the glory. And you're carrying an anointing. His name is Jesus. And you have within you that you don't wait for Pastor Dale. When Pastor Dale was sick on his bed, you didn't wait for him. You stood up. You picked yourself up and you declared life into him. You declared the fire of God to come and heal him. And that's what it's about. If we get stuck in a rut, if we get stuck in our circumstances, you're never going to move forward. Every one of you as children of God are in a place of metamorphosis. You're in a place of change. And God requires you to grow up in the anointing. I tell you, I have to smack myself sometimes because there's times I want to slap a couple of Christians because I want to say, you know, you need to get out of your head and let the Spirit of God get in your head. You need to let the Spirit of God, are you being spirit fed or what are you eating? What do you do? You're just running after somebody else's revelation? You're just running after somebody else's sermon for the week? What's God speaking to you in the midnight hour? Or in the daytime? Why do we have to wait till it's dark waiting for God to give us a dream? God doesn't just walk into the darkness. He's in the light. He's the glorious one. He's the truth, the way, and the light. So I'm telling the life. So I'm telling you, you better get ready because something is stirring in my spirit, man. When I was in Africa a year ago, I didn't know that the Lord was getting ready to move me into England. All I knew was the Lord said, go to Africa. I went in Africa. Did I want to be in Africa? No. After I'd got that, I thought, God, get me out of this country. It was the hardest trip in my life, you know. Very dangerous. A lot of things happening around me. And I wanted to come home. And the Lord said, no, you're going to England. Did I want to go to England? No, I want to see my grandbabies. I have this fleshly moment that erupts inside of me every now and then. You know, you want to be with your grandbabies. And I said, God, I'm going home. And the Lord said to me, no, you're going to England. And I go to do a meeting. And the pastor of this church, big church in Port Elizabeth, the church that my daddy came out of, that his father would drive John G. Lake over Africa around Jimmy Crompton's daddy, Pastor Crompton. Church that Kim Clements comes out of, that Rodney Hart Brown comes out of. That's my family's church in South Africa. And I was preaching there, and the secretary came to me as I was getting ready to leave. She handed me my offering, and she said, Robin, I got to tell you, are you going to England? I said, why? She said, somebody put 20 pounds in your offering. I was like, God, no. The Lord's been telling me for 4 days you're going to England. Just like last night, I told her, the night before last, the Lord spoke to me, you're going to Pennsylvania next week. Did I want to go to Pennsylvania next week? No, I'm ready to go make some sugar cookies and do some Christmas stuff. You know what I mean? With my grandbabies. And so I got up, I went downstairs, I said to them, her and Dick, I said, Dick, God says I'm going to Pennsylvania. Oh, no, oh, no, oh, no, oh, no. I get on Facebook, somebody I don't even know. When are you coming to Pennsylvania? Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Can I have a week off? Oh, Jesus. But you know what you got about? You got to be about your Father's business. It's not about you anymore. The minute you surrender everything, you have God-given assignments God is driving you into. God is blowing you into. John 3:8 says, no one knows where the wind comes from, where it goes. Thus is he who is born of the Spirit. Are you born of the Holy Ghost of fire? Are you born of the Spirit? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Then I'm going to tell you something. You need to shake off your agendas and you need to be still and let the Spirit of God birth things in you that you couldn't dream or fathom. You don't have to be a prophet. You don't have to be a teacher. You don't have to be an apostle. You just have to be a yielded vessel of God that's saying, all to Jesus I surrender. The minute you surrendered everything, you caught something in your spirit, man. God started feeding you. You became spirit-fed. If you're not spirit-fed, then you're not spirit-led. You've got caught. So here I was. The Lord says, you're going to Pennsylvania. No, 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 Jesus. I'm telling you, ask Irene, by this morning, 4 different places have booked me next week in Pennsylvania. 4 different places. I was like, I'm going home first now. I'm going home. I'm going home tomorrow. I'm going to be home because I got a meeting Sunday, and I got a meeting Monday. And then, God, you can have me Thursday. But can I have Wednesday off, you know? But it doesn't work that way. When you're driven by the voice of God, everything in you is in a place of perpetual expectation. When the Lord said to me, you're going to England, when I was in South Africa, and I said, no, God. And that secretary said, somebody put 20 pounds in your offering. I was like, oh, Jesus, I'm going to England. I'm going to England. And I thought, well, if I'm going to England, I'm going to see my girlfriends. They're all coming in from Ireland and all over. They're having a huge international woman's aglow in London, you know. And I was all excited. But I had to get a visa to go into England. My visa didn't show up till Friday. I missed the whole international glow. I missed all my friends. I flew out all night long, Friday night, arrived Saturday morning, 6 a.m. 6 a.m. into Southampton Airport. I went to get off that plane, and I'm telling you something, the fire of God come on me. I called a pastor that I knew in that area the day before, and I said, God says, I'm coming to England. He said, oh, I'm so glad you're finally coming. Now will you preach for me Sunday? I said, I'll be there Sunday. He picked me up at the airport Saturday morning, And he said, do you mind? My brother's here in town. Well, I know his brother. His brother's on Sid Roth. He's on God TV and all the rest of that stuff, you know. And I said, well, that's awesome. He lives in my hometown. He said, do you mind if we go to, he's having a conference. I said, I'll go with you. 2-hour drive from the airport. I've been up all night. All night long. I arrive in Southampton at 6 a.m. Drive another 2.5 hours or something to Southampton now from Heathrow Airport. When I get to this church, it's a cathedral. It is a theater. It's where Shirley Temple used to play and sing. And I walked in, and there's all, there must be 300 or 400 Christians gathered together at this conference. And Glenn, this guy's brother, was so excited. He said, Robin, I'm so glad you're here. You take the meeting. You take the meeting. I was like, I don't want your meeting. This is your conference. And he said, you take it. And as I stood there, I heard this song. Come away, my beloved. Come and walk with me. Come drink of my heartbeat. Oh, come and taste and see. And as I started singing, the glory, the anointing started falling. I mean, I could cry right now because the power of God hit this place. Come, my beloved. Come and walk with me. Come hear my sweetest love songs. Come and taste and see. And I was just singing, you know, and the glory, prophetic glory started falling all over. The songs of the Lord started birthing. You could feel the atmosphere, just the kabod of his presence. And as the Spirit of God fell, I'm telling you, he said, Glenn says, Robin, I want you to pray for this guy. And he led me to a young guy about 17 years old. When I walked up to him, I saw his body covered in lesions, covered in blood. But yet I never saw his body because he had clothes on. He had long sleeves on. But I saw like somebody had come and scratched at his body. And I said, the enemy came, and I started prophesying. And I did not know. The next thing I knew, he was out under the power of blood. He was out of the power of God, fallen on the floor. Glenn took me to another kid, 3 feet, 3 people down. 11-year-old boy, when I walked up to him, his whole face contorted into autism. I saw this demon, this autistic spirit jump out of his face. I said, you foul, tormenting spirit. I command you to loose him right now and set him free. And as I did that, he fell out shaking under the power of God. And I went on and on and on. I didn't know nothing. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about being his mouthpiece. It's not about your accolades. It's about the glorious one being revealed, displayed through everything you do. Because we have a nation. We have nations, we have cities, we have children that are hungering to see men and women of God that walk with signs and wonders following them. The Daniel 11:32 people, the people who know their God, that will carry out the exploits of heaven. And that's what the church lacks, because the church has become lactose intolerant. It's become schizophrenic. It doesn't know whose mind it is, and it doesn't know what it believes. All it knows is, God help us. If we don't go to church, we may not go to heaven. That ain't where it's at, folks. It's about, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you in a place of intimacy where you dwell in the shadow of the Almighty? You got to grow up in the anointing. That's why I want to slap a lot of Christians, because they get stuck. They just get stuck. They need to rise up and say, I'm taking up my bed, no matter what my problem is, no matter what my kids are going through, no matter who my husband is or my wife is, no matter who, what did what, I need to let it go, because you know what? All that stuff that happened is stuff, and it came because of sin. Those people who did it, they were full of the devil themselves. They were broken themselves. They needed a healing themselves. And God is just looking for you to reach into their darkness by the Spirit of God that's in you and pray for them and see them set free. You see, we judge people by outward appearances. But God is no respecter of persons. When I walked up to that young boy, unbeknownst to me, the 11-year-old boy was his brother. Unbeknownst to me, the Hindu aunt had come to visit. She found out they got saved. She put a curse on their family. Their father lost his job. The kid woke up one night, started scratching, tormenting spirits. His body became like raw flesh, all the blood coming out of him. His little brother was a brilliant, straight-A student. All of a sudden, was acting autistic. But let me tell you something. I'm so glad I know the power of the blood of Jesus. I'm so glad I know what was given to me, my inheritance right at the cross. I'm so glad that I'm not bound. I've been set free, and I don't have to worry, because guess what? If you worry, you die. If you don't worry, you still die. So why worry? You know, we get so worried. I walked up to the next kid, 22 years old. He come up. Pastor Glenn called him. Come here. His name was Joshua White. He said, if you heard his testimony, you have to hear his testimony. He said, I've been around the prophetic all my life. I just thought it was a bunch of hippies that did all that stuff. That's what he said. He said, but then she prophesied, and I started prophesying. I did not know he was the pastor's son. I said, the Lord says the same anointing that was on A. Allen will come upon you. You will move in the word of knowledge. The same mantle of the prophetic that's upon me. God says, I'm going to place the gift, the office of the prophetic on you. And I start prophesying. He fell out. I mean, he shook, violently shook under the power of God. You must see this guy right now. He is so on fire for Jesus. His whole life has been changed. We need an encounter with God. We need a Holy Ghost implosions going on in the church. We need the fire of God to walk into people's darkness and set them free. And he's wanting to do it, but people are so walls up. Don't want to do nothing. But listen, I don't care how many walls you have up. I walk with such an anointing that I'm like a Holy Ghost can opener. By the time it's open, I'm going to break through your tin can, your tin wall, and I'm going to show you what the blood of Jesus has got for you. And then tell you by the time it's done, you're going to say, thank God for Robin Tom Rogers, that she was obedient to the voice of God. And she walked in and she let the fire of God move through her, because it's not because I'm a legend in my own mind. I'm not just going to be a preacher that goes around preaching to get an offering or preaching so I can have a pulpit on a Sunday. I'm here with a vision. I'm here to tell you what Jeremiah said. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. Blessed is the man whose trust is in the Lord, for he will be like a tree planted by the waters that extends its roots by a stream and will not fear when the heat comes. You think I haven't gone through battles? Every one of you have gone through battles. Pastor Dale's gone through battles. We all walk through it. But let me tell you something. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me to lay down by green pastures. No matter how the waters are being stirred around me, as long as I keep my eyes on him, something's going to happen. Because you know why? God is moving by his Spirit. He's never stopped moving. Moving o'er all the earth. Signs and wonders where God's moving. Move, O Lord, through me. After I ministered at that church, we went up to have a cup of tea. The grandfather come up to me. He says, Robin. He says, no. He said, ma'am, who are you? I said, my name's Robin, Robin Tom Rogers. He said, did you have a father named Robert Tom? I said, I did. He said, your father preached here in 1967. I would bring him in, and he would come with a man named A. Allen. And we would rent a town hall, and only four people would show up. But they would preach like thousands were there. They didn't care. A. Allen used to push my son around in the baby buggy. That's the father of the boy you just said. God said the same anointing. You see, Jesus knows everything about us. And he knows our footsteps. And he does things that'll just blow our mind just to bring confirmation. You're in the right place. You're in the right situation. Don't let go. Hold on. Because your joy is not waiting for you tomorrow. Your joy is here right now. You just got to get up and say, Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. The glory of the Lord is upon me. It's within me. I carry the anointing. And you better have a nervous breakdown, because I'm here right now. I'm like God's Holy Ghost Shearer. You know what I mean? Oh, Shabunda. Ooh, Rabanda. Listen to this. It will not fear when the heat comes, but its leaves will be green. It will not be anxious in a year of drought. How many know that everybody's been this year? Oh, we better go buy some dried beans. We better get lots of water. We better put tons of gallons of gasoline. Now, God help us, we're all going to die. So what? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I look at some of these television evangelists right now that are selling all those dry beans on TV, and I'm thinking, what a shame. How many souls could you be winning? Now you've got everybody constipated and stinking with dry beans. And their beans are getting moldy. Nothing's happening. I'm just saying. I almost want to write them a letter and say, repent. Repent. The only time you read about anybody having any dry beans was Ezekiel, when he got to go lay naked in the middle of the street and throw ashes and dung on himself, and there was some beans there and some water. And only was some. Because let me tell you something, when you walk by the ways of the Spirit, God will cause it to multiply. He will. I've been there, done that. I walked in my house one night, I thought, dear God, I invited the singles to come. I invited an evangelist to come to my house for dinner. My husband invited the singles. I didn't invite them. They're like the feeding of the last 10,000. Forget 5,000. All these singles showed up. And here I am, and the evangelist is going, Robin, it looks like the feeding of the 5,000 here. And all I had was a pot of soup, split pea soup, and Jiffy cornbread. And vegetable pizza. You all know about vegetable pizza. You know that awesome pizza you make with crescent rolls. And I won't make anybody hungry, but glory, hallelujah, shabanda. You got to get the recipe. It's so good. So good. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord, I'm coming back. Okay. Went into the land of craft right then and there. Was having a moment with that cream cheese. Got to get away from that place. Oh, Glory Ranch was in the middle of it, Jesus. And then we had some scallions and some broccoli and cauliflower. Oh my God, that's a great recipe. Glory, hallelujah, Shabunda. Okay, I'm coming back. What I love about Jesus is one size fits all. You know what I mean? There ain't no, there is nothing fat free in heaven. Sure, just beam me up now, God. Oh, glory. Some of you need to get a grip. Some of you have a temple. Some of us have a cathedral. You'll be okay. Lord, help me, Jesus. That's my bacon tongue. I better behave myself. I'm coming back. I don't even know where I left off, but I'm coming back. Just let me get back there. Lord, I repent. And so here I was in my house, and I got stuck between the wall and the fridge. I got so drunk as a skunk, I couldn't move. I was laughing so hard. The fire of God was in the house. These people ate like it was the last dinner, and they kept eating, and the pot never got empty, and the Jiffy cornbread never ran out. And I only made one of those $1.99 boxes, you know, it was two for $3. I only made one of those boxes because I only had one egg, and I mean, it was amazing. The thing just multiplied. It just multiplied. I was like, thank you, Jesus. I just laid there. I put my hands on my belly. I said, come up, Holy Spirit, more. Spring up a well within my soul. Fill me up with fresh oil, fresh anointing. The psalmist says, I shall be refreshed with fresh anointing. People get so stuck on living on yesterday's prophecy. Oh, my God, they've got it so locked in their mind, and they can't. I got a woman that calls me all the time. Robin, some prophet gave me this prophecy. He gave it to me in 1983, and it hasn't come to pass yet, Robin. I said, shut up. Just shut up. You've wasted your whole life trying to figure out a prophecy. You know, how do you know that God wasn't prophetless? I mean, come on. Just put it on a shelf. When it's supposed to come to pass, it'll come to pass. We get so consumed with prophecies, we clog up the well of God within us. You need to quit running after this prophet and that prophet. You need to get out of your head, and you need to get in the blood. Get under the covering of the blood. Get in the shelter of the anointing. I'm going to be good now. Okay. What happens is a lot of people don't understand that there are things that the enemy will do. He will bring anxiousness to you when you're going through a moment of drought. He'll bring fear to you. The Bible says the heart is more deceitful than all else, and it's desperately sick. Did you know that? Who can understand it? Who can understand it? But God knows it. God knows our heart. And listen, what happens is when you get so caught up in trying to figure out something, you become root bound. Did you know that? Your roots don't flourish no more. They don't look for the stream. What starts happening is you start suffocating in your own thoughts and your own trying to working out your salvation and working out your ministry and working out your giftings and working out. And then you got to go to the deliverance ministry and you got to find somebody that's at least done 30 weeks of it so that they're really good and trained. I'll behave. Oh my God, when I grew up, there wasn't 30 weeks of deliverance training, honey. When they brought the man barking like a frog to the front door of our house, and he was wrapped in chains, and he was just got his underwear on, there was no waiting for Derek Prince to come to town or anybody else. It was Satan, come out in Jesus' name. Devils come out. The chains broke off, and the man was set free, no longer barking like a dog. When Sister Mary come down the road from the top of High Level Road down to our house with her husband's neck with a leash around it, and she is in her bra and panties, bringing that man to my father's front door, wants him to cast the devils out. Now, which one would you have chosen to do first? She didn't even think she had a devil. There's some strange things out there. Strange. If you were in the ministry right now, some of you couldn't handle the ministry. Because it can be a misery if you don't stay in the covering of the blood. It can be hard. Ooh, it can be. But you know what it comes down to is, do you know? Do you know the sound of the abundant rain? The voice of many waters? Do you know his thoughts so deep within? It causes you to draw into the waterfall of his amazing ways as he bears his heart and he heals your shame in the waterfall of his amazing grace. Can you hear his song? There's a sound, a perpetual sound. All the time God is stirring you. All the time he's awakening you. Isaiah said, the Lord awakeneth me morning by morning. He awakeneth my ear as one being taught. When Daniel was crying out for the captivity of the children of Israel, for them to come out of Babylonian captivity, the angel of the Lord came to him in Daniel 9 and said, Daniel, I have come to skill you and teach you in the ways of God. Everybody wants to go on a 40-day fast so they can shortcut their ministry. You don't want to do that. You can go on your fast. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, to wait. We all want a shortcut to just a quickening touch of God. Well, I'm going over to Brother So-and-So's. I'm going to this group. I'm going to that group. You've got groups emerging right now in this city that you need to pray through about. You better discern the spirits and know they're of God. Don't care who they are. When Rodney Ad Brown came to Louisville, Kentucky, I didn't say, oh, he's the greatest revivalist. I discerned the spirit. Is this man of God? And I found out he was of God. You know why? Because I got hit upside the head with the Holy Ghost 2x4. The power of God got a hold of me. I hit the floor and everything that wasn't of God flung out the window. It ran, honey. It scattered. And when I got up off that floor, I knew, thank God, I am changed, changed, changed. I've been born again. I mean, I thought I was saved. But I found out that night there's a place of intimacy. If you don't dwell in the intimacy of God, if you don't dwell in the thoughts of God, if you don't stay in the right wind of God, you know, when I started this, I said tonight, John 3:8, no one knows where the wind comes from. I had a vision when I was in Ireland. Just come back from Ireland. I'm getting ready to go to Ireland again. Whole of Ireland's opened up to me. I just come in from Ireland. I had a vision. While I was in this meeting, There was a huge bunch of leadership there. And I saw the Lord, and he was this giant eagle. And he was preening the feathers of all these eaglets. And he said to me, "Watch, Robin, what they do." And I watched as he led them to the edge, as he had fed them, and as he had preened them, and he had, as he had got them ready, and he released them into the wind of the Holy Spirit. And then he said, "Do you see, Robin?" And I saw there were some that flew right in with the wind of the Spirit. They were in the direct plan that God had, but there's some that got caught up in their own imaginations, and they got caught up in the wrong wind. And they drug others with them. They drug. Let me tell you something. Birds of a feather flock together. They flock together. But eagles fly. They soar above the clouds. They go with the wind of the Spirit. I'm telling you, God is requiring. There's very few true prophets in this hour. Don't let people tell you there's, 1,000 prophets out there. Even Elijah recognized. He knew there was a whole school of prophets, but he went up to the mountain. Am I the only one, God? You know how many times I've got to a place where I've said, "God, I know I'm not anybody, but I know I hear your voice. And God, what is happening in this hour? What's going on?" Job 29:19 says this, "My roots will reach to the waters." You've got to keep yourself planted in the river of life, in the river of the anointing. In other words, the anointing. You've got to go by the anointing of the Spirit of God. Listen, I love the scripture. I've been telling it all week. "My roots will reach to the water, and the dew will lie all night on my branches." What is God? He's the vine with the branches. He's anointing you all the time. Fresh anointing, that's the dew. Fresh anointing. And then it just seeps in. It just seeps in. It takes hold of whatever it settles on. Is God settling in your spirit with his anointing? Or is he just being pushed away because you've got some other agenda, some other thought that you just, "Well, I got touched. A little dab will do me." Don't be yabbity-dabbity-do. There's a brooding in my spirit, man. I'm telling you, I'm never in my life. I've grown up so much in the last just a year and a half, Pastor Dale. There's something, I've become more focused. I don't care how many people are in a church. If people want to leave, God bless you. Don't let the door hit you where the good Lord split you. I want to be around people who are hungry for the anointing of God, that are thirsty for the anointing of God. You know? My pastor, even he's something else. He said, "You can always tell when you're taking an offering, those who jump up and go to the toilet, what they're sowing into and what they're going to reap." It's the truth. It's the absolute truth. I think every church needs a good spiritual bowel movement so we can just move on. I'm telling you. They need to be shake, rattled, and rolled. I want to be around dead branches. I want to be around dead vines. You know what I'm saying? I want to be around people who have allowed the water of God to water their spirit, that have not got caught up in all what Sister Bucketmouth said and what Brother Bucketmouth said, and they recognize there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. I'm not going to get caught up in the condemnation of men, and I'm going to move forward, and I'm not settling for second best. I want everything God's got, and then I want the Holy Spirit to come and skill me and teach me in the precious intimacy of God. I want to see what Jesus saw from the cross when he gave his last breath. I want to see the defeated. I want to see the broken. I want to see the rejected. I want to see the abused. I want to see them with such a compassion in me that I'll lay down my life and say, "God, whatever you want me to do, I'll go into the brokenness. I'll go into the defeated. I'll go to the lost. Whatever you cry out in my Spirit, God, I'll be your vessel. I'll be your hand extended." Because true Christians of God, people who had a real intimate experience with God, have the intimacy of kindness towards the worst of the worst that they will ever meet. I'm telling you, I know this. My spirit yearns. It's been laying prostrate before the throne room of God. "From my lips like honey from a honeycomb, I have poured exclamations. How great thou art! How great thou art!" See, it's your God. When last did you just treasure him? When last did you treasure the gift of Jesus? When last did you carry it in such a way that it was so important to you, it was so dear to you, you didn't want anybody to touch what God had given you? You didn't want them to take it away from you. But there's an old song. For you to know the intimacy, for you to know the heartbeat of God, I don't care how saved you are. Give it all. Give it all. Give everything to Jesus. Give it all to Jesus. Every broken dream. You know how many Christians are in church that have broken dreams? Their lives are broken. Their marriages are a mess. Their kids are a mess. Their job's a mess. They don't have anything. They're just crying out. They have everything, but they don't know what they have because the devil's told them you have nothing. And all you know what we did? We had 10 kids in my family, 9 when I came along, the one before me passed away. My father always said, my children never had to wear secondhand shoes. God always supernaturally blessed them. When I was 5 years old and we went to Lebanon, Ohio, and I saw Mr. Ed for the first time, I was brought up in such a world of faith that I believed God. My daddy said, you just asked Jesus. I was 5 years old. Lord, I thank you for Mr. Ed. I thank you for my Mr. Ed. And here comes a man named Blaine Amberger. His mother walked the church. She said, honey, God's speaking to me. I'm going to give you a horse, a little white one. You can name him. I said, that's my Mr. Ed. She gave me a real live horse. I got my Mr. Ed. Tell me. Doesn't matter what age you are. If only the children, if we would have faith like the children. If we would have faith like the children. Within my heart, there's a deep yearning. Lord, I'm hungry for a mighty move of God. Lord, I'm thirsty. Pour out your Holy Ghost. Lord, I long to see the hand of God move mightily inside of me. I'm hungry for a move of God. When last did you ask God, come move mightily inside of me? You know, your flesh will tell you, well, that's selfish. No. No. He who hungers and thirsts after righteousness shall be fed. You're going to be filled to overflowing. Filled. How hungry are you? The children of Israel knew God's supernatural provision. But you know what? They got lost in the motion of the wilderness. We got people in church that get lost in the motion of an agenda. In a social event. I just preached 2 weeks ago. I almost quit the ministry. I thought, my God, I'm quitting. In fact, I called a friend of mine and said, can you just tell me, how do I take a church? Just find me a church. I heard there's 1,000 churches. Everybody's jumping ship. Find me a church. I will take a church. I was done. I mean, you know what it's like to preach to people who have no hunger and no thirst? I was at a church in Kempwood, Texas, with the Baptists and the Methodists. And the greatest hunger was, what is the recipe we're eating at lunchtime? I thought, God, did I miss my calling? I should have been a dentist because I feel like I'm pulling teeth. 4 meetings of pulling teeth. 4 meetings. I just wanted to leave. I wanted to, please, I couldn't leave. There was no way to leave because there was no way. I had no car. I was out in the desert. I wanted to die. I said, God, beam me up now. But let me tell you something. By the time it was over with, those ladies knew. They knew, because there ain't no devil that's bold or strong enough that's going to hold me back from bringing forth a revelation of who Christ is and what he can do. He's here right now. He's here right now. He's watering your spirit. There's a fire in this place. I feel the manifested presence of God here. He's quenching your thirst. Now, some of you have been in a dry land. Listen, it's not because of Pastor Dale and his wife's fault. You got to pick up your bed. Even Jesus said, I can do nothing because of their unbelief. So what the Lord said to me when I was in Kempwood, Texas, Robin, I could do nothing. But what do you think? You think you're better than me? And you know what else Jesus knew? He knew he needed the anointing. If you don't know you need the anointing, then something's wrong with you. He knew, I need everything my Father has to give me. I can do nothing unless the Father shows me. We got to recognize, listen, you've got so much laid out for you. You have, as children of God, I'm not just here, and I'm gonna quit, but I'm asking you this. Once the children of Israel had tasted the manna and the quail, once they were touched by the hand of God, once they had seen everything provided for them, they still grumbled. Because you know why? They were looking to man to fix everything for them. They forgot Jesus. The Bible says, if two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm there in the midst of them. If we would gather together with one vision and one voice, there's no telling what we can't do. There's no telling. There's no telling. God's word, his thoughts always carry strength. They carry you on. They carry weight. Let me tell you something, this. It is the ointment of God that's the empowerment of God. It's his anointing. And every one of you, you've born again, you've had an acquaintance. You've had an encounter with the anointing. Now it's for you to carry it. What are you going to do with what God's given you? Where are you going with what God has for you? It's just like this man. I don't know this man, but I know there's a powerful prophetic anointing on him. I know he's got revelation in his spirit. I know he's got a prophetic sound in him. I know he's not just a man of God that gets up and maybe preaches a word. There's more in him than that. He carries a weight of glory. Now, let me tell you something. I can tell you right now, just looking at him and just telling him, not even looking at him, he's paid a price. He's probably been bitten. He's probably been stabbed at. Somebody's probably come and accused him of everything. He's probably been stabbed in the back, ridiculed, condemned. Because there's always somebody out there to help you remain condemned. Crucified. But do you know what made him? What's made his ministry and what's made him is that he kept his eyes on Jesus. Same thing with Pastor Dale. There's others in this house tonight. You've walked through your own valleys. But you know what you've learned? I'm going to pick up myself. I'm going to stand fast in the things of God. I'm going to pick up that garment of righteousness. I will never let it go. It's on me. And I'm not waiting for somebody to come fix it for me. My daddy was dead by the time I was 20 years old. The only time I ever cried for my father was the day I got touched in Rodney Howard Brown's meeting, and I was driving down Highway 65, and the fire of God fell on me, and I started speaking in divers tongues, and I went into so many different tongues. I knew what was righteousness. I knew what was weeping. I knew what was anger. I knew what was joy. I knew what was mourning. I knew things in my spirit. God just... I knew what was prophetic utterance, intercession. And I pulled over on the side of the road because the weight of his presence and what God was revealing to me was so strong. I said, God, I wish my daddy would be here so he could teach me what you're doing, what you're giving me right now, what you're showing me. And the Heavenly Father that I love said, Robin, I'm here. I'm your daddy. I'll teach you. Because we always look to men. But what did the songwriter say? Show me your face, God. Show me your face and gird up my legs that I might stand in this holy place. Show me your face, Lord, your power and grace. I can make it to the end if I can just see your face. Oh, I just love the Lord. Last year I was in Ireland. I was trying to find the picture of it, but I couldn't. I was in Ireland, and God led me into so many divine appointments. That's all I'm going to say, because maybe it's not time. I walked into a divine appointment that blew my mind. God started showing me a new pattern of the prophetic. He started telling me a new dimension of the prophetic is coming on you, another mantle. Because there's dimensions, there's realms, there's levels of the anointing that God calls you. You can start out as a prayer warrior and just be like little prayers and da-da-da, but all of a sudden you'll start seeing a crescendo of increase coming on you. God will start releasing more and more things. All of a sudden you'll find out that government anointing that's on your life is stronger than just anything you've ever walked in, and you'll start speaking with such an authority that even the devils will have a nervous breakdown. God had spoken to me about a woman. Told me to go pray for this woman. I don't know who the woman was. I just said to the lady who was driving me, God wants me to pray for your mother-in-law. She didn't even know where her mother-in-law lived. Her mother-in-law had moved because the father-in-law had been put in a home. The mother-in-law moved in with a sister. The sister had moved to a bigger house. So God said, go pray for him. Next thing I know, we're going to go pray for that woman. Her husband even said to her, you know, it's funny that Robin would want to pray for my mummy, because I just gave my sister Olive Robin's dad's book, The New Wine is Better. And I know my mummy's read it because she told me she had and she really enjoyed it. And now you're saying that she wants to go pray for my mummy. That's what he said. And we're driving down the road and my friend Ruth didn't know where mummy lived. But out of my spirit, man, I drove by this house on the left-hand side. Was this beautiful staff like Moses would have walked with. There was a holly bush on it. There was a sign on the side of this house said, Shiloh Shaddai, home of God. And I said, oh, your mummy lives around here somewhere, your mother-in-law does. She said, I don't be thinking so, Robin. I think she'd be down the road down that way. I said, a wee bit down that way. I said, no, she's over here. And right across the street from that sign was two houses with this row of houses. They were facing like this. And there was a wall between the two houses, a wall. And all of a sudden, I said, drive into that driveway. Your mummy lives there. She says, I don't be thinking so, Robin. I really don't. I don't think she's living there. I said, I'm telling you right now, your mummy lives there. Next thing I know, let me tell you something. We drove into that driveway. It had been drizzling rain because that's Ireland. The rain had lifted, the sun had come out, and there, what would you believe, on the wall, and I can't find the picture now because it's just not here, but that's okay, it's the norm with me. When I want something, the devil tries to hide it, but I find it eventually. But on the wall was a watermark, a shadow, very, very distinct of the map of Africa on the wall. It was amazing. On the wall. I said, your mommy lives here. No, she doesn't. I said, yes, she does. I said, you see that? That's a watermark of Africa. That's a watermark. That's a sign to me. I'm from Africa. God's brought me here. Your mommy lives here. She says, well, let me take a wee peep in the window, and I'll see if she lives here. I said, you'd be taking a wee peep in the window in America, they'd be shooting you between the eyes. We don't be peeping in nobody's window. We don't, do we? We call a peeping Tom. Oh, the glory of your presence, we your people, we give you reverence. So arise, oh my soul, to the wonders of my King. Oh, we just exalt you tonight. My friend went and looked into that window. She knocked on the door, and there was Mummy. Mummy, 89 years old in a right facilities, a right mind, faculties. I walked in. She never smiled, very stoic, because that age they were very stoic, you know. If you ever had an older parent, if you were born before the 50s, or in the 50s, I wasn't born before 50s. I'm a very, very young woman. And if you were born, you would know that back then the parents were pretty stoic. Didn't tell you they loved you. Very hard. They very hard. I walked in that house. I followed Mummy. She sat down, and this song came to me. Here's a strange woman, doesn't know me from Adam, and here I am. Do you mind if I sing over you? She's like, and this is me. I'm like, God knew what he did when he named me Robin, you know? When the red, red Robin comes bobbing along, that's me. And I start singing. God walks the dark hills, a very old song. The highways and byways. He walks in the billows of life's troubled seas. He walks in the cold, dark night, shadows of midnight. God walks the dark hills just to guide you and me. And then I started prophesying. And I said, man, the Lord says even as he knows what about me. And he's brought me here from Africa. And even as he's put the sign of Africa on your wall out there, God says he knows what happened to you and he knows what happened in Africa. And I start prophesying. She didn't weep. She didn't do nothing. But let me tell you what happened. I prayed. I laid hands on her. She was miraculously healed. Stood straight up. No problems with her knees. No more hunchback. Totally miraculously healed. I walked out the door and never said nothing to the woman. I left. 3 days later, I get a phone call. Ruth took me to dinner. We were having some bangers and mash. She says, Robin, you know that thing about the African thing? Well, I'd be telling my husband about the African. I showed him the picture you took. And he was saying, you know, there's more to that story. And she says, well, what do you mean, Austin? He says, well, you know, Ruth, nobody knows that I lost my brother, one of my brothers in the Ivory Coast of Africa. And my mother has always grieved over this brother. But Jesus knows. Jesus knows. See, everything God does is a 3D to it. It's never the first thing. I would have thought the first thing was God gave me the, show me the Shaddai. Then he shows me the house, shows me the wall. Then he brings me in and that was it. But there's always more to it, folks. There's always more. You've got to be still and let God be God in your life. You've got to be still. Every one of you is standing amazed right now in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. Because he's going to cause your spirit, man. By the time I'm done tonight, we're going to pray for a few people. Is that okay for you? It's very hot in here. Is it just me or do I feel like I should have worn a bikini or something? I won't tell you my bikini shrunk. I just won't. Pastor Dale was like, oh, my Jesus, help me, God. Somebody help me down off here because I got to sit down for a second. Just, oh, there he is, tall and good looking. Aren't you related to that man over there somehow? Shame on you. Hallelujah. That's what I usually say to all my African friends, tall, dark, and good looking. I always nurture when the ugly men start looking good. It's time to leave town. Nobody's looking good here tonight, so there can't be many ugly men here. Some of you need to put your hands in your belly and say, Joy, I know that you're in there. Come out. Shabunda, Sister Hat back there. Sister Hat, that's you, Sister Beanie. Stand up. She looks like Sister Beanie. Usually people put a hat on when they've had a bad hair day. Nah. Come out here, Sister Beanie. Mr. Bling, Sister Bling Bling, you're a bling bling woman. You, Miss Beanie. Don't take your shoes off anything. We're not, it's not a holy ground situation. That's, the holiness is here. That's it. I'm talking to you, right? There's another blingy here. Stand next to her, my sister blingy. Are you two related in any way? You're not, are you? But you're the size of one of my thighs. You're so skinny, it's a shame. She's got my body, but it's trapped. Now, oh, can I have my, can you put my CD, can you put my iPad on? Does Mr. Soundman, can you play an iPad? You can't play an iPad? What's wrong with you up there? Oh, Jesus, you can't play an iPad at all. I'm going to put that on for a second. You've got so many bracelets. They're not all Pandora, are they? Because I'd be saying that's a mission trip for me. My daughter said, I want to buy you a Pandora bracelet. I said, no, it's a mission trip. Don't buy me one. I'm serious now. I'm dead serious. I mean, you can't take it with you. I ain't going to take anything that you can't take with you. I want something that's, you know, it's going to finance the ministry. It's going to take care of me. My kids said, what do you want for Christmas? I said, don't buy me anything expensive. Rather, sew it into my offering. You know, that's what I tell my kids. And they said, Mom, you're so special. We just want to give you something special. I said, don't fight with each other. Do you know what it's like to be in Africa and your 33-year-old son calls you because he's fighting with his 32-year-old sister? You're just like, And it's gone, and you know what it is? The 2 days from now, it's going to be done. But they've sucked the life out of you in the midst of it. You know what I mean? Have you ever been there, Pastor Dale? It's like, shut up. You know, if your kids call you and want to get divorced, good. They're at least not killing each other. Get divorced. Do whatever you want. Just don't come to me when you're sad and sorry, and then you want me to redo your vows. I'm just talking. How old are you? 19 or 30? 21. Are you married yet? Have you met Mr. Wright? Good. It's not time. You never get married before you're 24 or 26. It's very important you remember that. Very important. Because you know why? The hand of God's on your life too. And that doesn't mean that's not the reason why you don't get married. Have you got my iPad yet? Are you on the playlist? Do not put Adele on, okay? There's a playlist that's already Holy Spirit, Rita Springer. It's a playlist. Hit playlist. The code is 091059. Don't anybody remember that code. Did you get it? Okay. There's a playlist there. Just hit playlist. Is it ready to go? It starts with Holy Spirit come. Or it starts with, what's the other one, Irene? The first one. Give me something. Cave City. Give me Cave City. Hallelujah. Just hit Cave City. There's a whole list for Cave City. Oh, you know they found out that Creflo Dollar had an illegitimate child. His name's 50 Cent. That's good. That's good. That was really good. You all didn't get it. Let's get back under the anointing, okay? Because I've got to... Just letting you have a little... Don't you love that God has a sense of humor? 21 years old. Hallelujah. Ascribe unto the Lord. Say, everybody, get your eyes on Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Jesus. Father, I just thank you for the anointing of your presence that comes in such a way. Don't keep it turned up. For he is holy and he is worthy of. God, you're so worthy. All of the glory and all of our praise. Oh, we just love you tonight. We just love you tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to start with this lady here first. Father, I thank you for the anointing of your presence. Give me a hand. I see you standing and you walk into this house. And there's like these two posts on either side before the house on the porch. And you walk under the portal of the door. And you walk inside. And the Spirit of the Lord brings you into a room that is just beautiful with hardwood floors. And your heart is leaping within you because there's things you want to see that have to change. And your spirit's been crying out, Lord, you bring the rain, you make a way, you do something different. Because the Lord says, daughter, there's an end to all of yesterday's pain. This is a new hour in your life, says the Lord. This is a new day. This is a new day of utterance and vision. This is a quickening of my spirit, for great and mighty are my ways unto you, and great are my thoughts over you. So the Lord says, rise, my daughter, and know that I've given you creative abilities to display things that others would not even know. The Lord says, don't underestimate your beauty. Don't underestimate your talents, but know the Spirit of the Lord is on your life, and it's breaking through for you right now. There's a spirit breakthrough that's coming through on your behalf. And you're going to say, the Lord has made me into the woman of God. He wants me to be. Great and mighty are his ways for me. Now, are you married to her? Yes. Have a husband. Is that your husband? The hand of God for both of your lives. You know that, don't you? There's something changing in your life. It's like a just clock, and I can see like a pendulum. I don't know if you have a big clock or what you got, but I see this pendulum. And I just see God saying the time and the season is now. And there's change coming. And the Lord says, even down to the finances and the money and the work, there's change coming, says the Lord. this is your day of breakthrough. Says God. Fresh fire upon your life. Fresh anointing. I speak breakthrough. Lift your hands, both of you. Just lift your hands up. Say, Lord, I thank you. God, you've blessed us. And God, there's a greater blessing you're bringing our way. And Lord, we receive it tonight. It's almost like I can see these flowers that they try to close up and they weren't budding. But God says, now they will blossom. The Lord says, the season has changed. Things are going to blossom for both of you. And you're going to say, the Lord has made a way. Makes sense to you, sir. That makes sense. What do you do? What do you do? Yes. Oh, my God, you take gorgeous pictures. I love it. Father, I thank you for this. There's something about your house. God's church. I don't know if you have a heart of gold. You have a heart of gold. But I just see something changing about a house. Get ready, says the Lord. Touch of heavens on both of you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're in a healing process. You're in a healing process. There's things in your heart that God's just going to cause to bubble up. Bubble up with joy. Bubble up with healing. You say, the Lord, that's the touch of God moving into your belly right now. That's the touch of God just burning in your spirit. The Lord says, daughter, I'm going to show you what it is to yearn and long after me, to pant after the waters. Jesus. Let me tell you about your life. There's a spiritual heritage in your life. There's an anointing. Come forward. You're going to sit down here. You see, it's all right. There's a spiritual inheritance. I can see you. It's almost like you don't even know the half of what you have to give. Like I see this tray and it has surgical tools on it. And I see you looking at them and thinking, what is this? The Lord says, daughter, the healing of the nations will come forth in this hour. People will say signs and wonders are happening everywhere. God says there's a healing anointing in your life. And you're going to see the signs and wonders. You're going to say, I prayed, I just sang, and the anointing fell, and people were touched, and they were healed, and they were never the same. Because you've got such a compassion, such a tender heart. Jesus, I'm going to go around this room a little bit, is that okay? I'll tell you who I like a lot in this house. This lady here in purple, maroon. Come, Sister Maroon, you. Come, Sister Maroon. Stand right there. Father, I thank you right now that every dream that's been broken, I turn it down for a while. It's like bubbles were busted. They were popped. You can turn down a little bit. And I see you standing there saying, God, why? Why did this happen? What was the purpose? What was the reason? The Lord says, daughter, it was never my design. God says, in a blink of an eye, I'm going to change everything. The lies that the enemy has tried to purpose even in you. Say, what is it for? What are you for? You're my daughter, says the Lord. I'm bringing you into the waterfall of my love, the waterfall of my anointing, the waterfall of peace. And you're going to say, God's putting a fresh oil upon me today. He's anointing my head with fresh oil. I'll never be the same. I see you just standing there in this waterfall and your hands, God just put his hands on your hands and he's just washing your hands together. Just washing your hands together. He's saying, I'm cleansing it out of you. Let go of it. Put it in my hands. Put the situation in my hands, says the Lord, for you've carried it too long. I don't know what I'm talking about because it's not for me to know, but it's the Spirit of God. It's the Spirit of God that's speaking to you. So the wind of the Spirit is getting ready to blow from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. And you're going to say, the Lord came. Fresh, Lord, I lose the fire of God. I lose the fire of God in Jesus' name. And I say, never the same. Never the same. You can turn that down. Thank you. I was really looking for Rita Springer, is what I was looking for. We've had so much of Bethel, I'm kind of worn out with Bethel. No rudeness intended, but I'm just done with. Love Carrie Job, love all of them, but just, whoo, Shabunda, Borda, Be, Shabunda. Who feels the presence of God in you? Is it just me? Does that make sense to you, Sister Maroon? Is this your husband? How are you doing, sir? Good man. Good man. She only has to beat you twice a week, so you're a good man. I really like you, but not to marry you, but I really like you. There's such something in your spirit that just leaped in my spirit. It's kind of like when Mary came in contact with Elizabeth. That anointing comes in contact with each other, and you recognize the authority of it, and you recognize that you've endured and you've gone through things and you've never let go. You've times when you thought, dear God, what now? But the Lord says the hands is on you. There's a new place that God's taking you into. It's almost like the weight, there's weights that at times people put upon you, just drawing you down and draining you down. I see these big bell, what do you call them, barbells, just weights. You know those, but they're the single ones with the loop on them. And it's just, Lord says, you just let it go. Yeah, care about. God says, just let it go. God says, I'm going to move some weights out of your way. There's some situations and circumstances of things that's just been around you. God says, it's moving away right now. God says, I'm rolling it all away. And I just see you walking into even a new vicinity, even a new, it's like a fresh place, a fresh church, a fresh place. I don't know if this makes any sense to you, but I just see you walking into a brand new door and a brand new people and with thoughts, and you're going to bring them the thoughts that God has placed in you and the words of wisdom, and you're going to just lay it before them like somebody would lay out a table, a banqueting table, and God says they're going to celebrate you. They're going to celebrate the anointing that's on you. That's how I'm going to start opening doors before you in different vicinities that people will say. And I know you said, well, people love me. No, not like this. God says they're going to celebrate the anointing that's on your life. It's time to be celebrated. This couple over here, are you two together? Are you, sir? Are you two together? Is this your wife? It is. There's some health issues. Stand up, sir. Stand up. I just see the hand of God. Don't give up, says the Lord. You're going to change. Some things are going to really change. You know, I'm the healthiest heavy woman the doctors have seen. They've told me this. Every time they see you, don't you love doctors? You must have diabetes. You've got to have. I'm watching skinny people drop dead all around me, and I'm like, this past year, I went through hell this past year. They told me I had endometrial cancer. They told me everything. Oh, you can imagine all the stuff they told me. After 20,000 tests, I'm not kidding you, test after test, 17 vials of blood, all the stuff. You know what? I have nothing wrong with me. There's nothing. I'm a healthy, fat woman. I enjoy myself. I even went for deliverance to see if I had a demon of gluttony. I don't. There was nothing that screamed out abuse, no inner child that was broken. Nothing. They couldn't find anything. I told my pastor I did that because I snuck out in the middle of the night. Here I'm at the greatest ministry in the world, Rodney Ad Brown's ministry, living on his property, and I go to see if I need deliverance because I'm eating too much. I just like to eat. That was the result. I don't have a demon. I just like to eat. I enjoy food. Beam me up. But I know. And then you have the wonderful people who tell you you're going to die and go to hell because that's a sin. If that's the worst sin, God help me. People think if you smoke, you're going to hell. Do you know you're not going to go to hell? You're going to smell like hell when you get to heaven, but you're not going to go to hell. People think because you're speaking tongues, you're going to go to heaven. No, that's not how it works. You better make sure your heart's right with Jesus. Lift your hands. I want to call you Brother O'Reilly or Madigan. You look like a little Irish leprechaun is what you do. Are you from Ireland? Do you have some Irish roots in there somewhere? Don't tell me it's German because you're too short to be German. Is there Irish in there? There is. It's a good thing. Look at the ruddy cheeks on the man. On the face. Do you know Mr. O'Flanagan? You're getting ready to get drunk as a skunk in the Holy Ghost. In your belly, there's going to come rivers of living water. Not your liver, but the river. The fire, the shabonda, the banda, bosabi. Come stand over here, Mr. Flanagan. Mr. Flanagan, the healing balm of Gilead is going to go through your body. God's going to restore to you some strength that maybe you've been a little bit tired, but it's because you've got to quit sitting down and watching the TV and you've got to get out there. You don't even like football, I don't think. You don't like football, do you? I didn't think so. But you know, you can't be watching Dancing the Stars and call yourself saved. You don't watch Dancing with the Stars, do you? Thank God. Lord, I had to do the Catholic thing. I'm an HGTV woman myself, you know, that flip-a-flop thing. Am I in the wrong church? I love that show. Oh, my gosh, somebody build me a house. Lord, I thank you for the joy unspeakable, the ha-has, the ho-hos, and the shabunda banda binda banda bida banda bees. The strength of heaven comes over thee. The flame of his spirit burns mightily. The joy, the manda, subunda banda be. The garabusu rada banda rada busi and rada busi. He shububusa banda busha banda banda be. Fresh oil. Fresh oil, Father, from the top of his head. I just see an angel of the Lord standing over you just with an urn, and he's just pouring oil from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. A fresh anointing, God says. I don't understand this, but I just see a loss. There was a loss, and I see God just right now just healing. Fire. Oh, there's the fire of God going into your heart, going into your chest, going into your lungs. There's the anointing. More, God, fill him up. I can feel it flowing through me. Holy Spirit, come and fill him up. Oh, come and fill him up. Oh, shabunda basabi. Now, Lord, he looks like he's been drinking a little. His cheeks are so red. But we know it's Holy Ghost wine. Well, we'd have to make him walk the line. But he ain't a Johnny Cash. He's not walking the line, God. He's right on the right side of the line. He's full of Jesus. Fire is all over him. Fresh, fresh fire. My Lord, people don't fall down in this church. You're going to have to trip him. It's good stuff, isn't it? Do you snort when you laugh? Is that your wife? My Lord, you look like you stole her out of the cradle. Come here. Come here, wife. My God, it must be your fourth wife. Is it your third? Your only wife? My God. Jesus loves you. So sweet. You're such a good woman. How you doing? It's good, isn't it? It's a joy unspeakable and full of glory. Full of glory. People say, why she laughed? The Bible says the merry heart doeth good like a medicine. That's what it said. Some of you need a laugh. You need to have a laugh. You look like you've been sucking on lemons too long. It's a joy unspeakable and full of glory. And the half has never yet been told. Father, this is your couple, your children. They're people of destiny. They love you with an unfathomable love. Now, God gives them the desires of a heart. I break any headaches that would come. Any headaches. I don't know if you've ever had headaches, but I feel headaches. When I took your hand, I felt headaches. And I break it. It's very horrible. It's a horrible feeling. It's like a spirit of oppression at times would come on you. I take authority over that tormenting spirit. I command this vice that he's put around your mind, that he's put around your head. I speak to the veins in your very brain right now. I speak to the veins to be opened, to the arteries to be made whole. I speak oxygen to come. I break this thing behind your retina even. I loose healing from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. And Satan, I bind the spirit of oppression. Free this day. Free this day. Free in Jesus' name. It comes off of you. And it goes. I break those headaches, and I command them to go. I command them to go. And, sir, I'm going to tell you, the Lord says, don't let your heart be downtrodden. God says, don't give up. Don't be afraid. Don't worry. Because God says, son, I made mansions. I've made the very fields and the lilies. I've caused the rose of Sharon to come forth in your life. God says, would I not make a way for both of you, for you and your wife? Have I not even put your feet in the path of righteousness in this house? So the Lord says, don't worry. Just trust me. I'll make the way. It's already done. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. That's a God word. Is that a God word? Give me a hug, Mr. Bubbly Man. Little leprechaun. Come, Sister Leprechaun. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, there's our new preacher back there. How you doing? Tall, dark, and good-looking. Is this your wife next year? It's both of you. Aren't you, like, related to these poor people? You got some good kids. Good. And you? How old are you now? 19 or 20? Yes. 19. You're not related to them, are you? Surely not. Oh, you're my deepest sympathy. Stand up. What do you play? Drums. What else do you play? Guitar. One more. Piano. Anything else? Those are the three, aren't they? Other than a tambourine. Did you try the trumpet? I like the sax. Saxophones, me. Jesus. You know, you hear many melodies. When somebody plays when somebody plays by the Spirit, they play in a realm that men cannot think. And they play notes and melodies that come from heaven's throne room, you see. When somebody plays in the natural, they just play a sound. But when they play by the Spirit, you can hear the volume of the voice of God moving all around. So the Lord says, there are things, son, that I will cause you to discern. The ways and the workings of the Spirit, even in melodies, and the ways and the workings of the earthly things. But the Lord says, your spirit has not even seen or attained the fullness of the place that I'm getting ready to birth in you this day. So the Lord says, son, there's a musical ability in their thoughts and their melodies that will come out of the Spirit, out of the realms of the Spirit. And you will say, surely, as I stepped in the heavens with my voice, and as I allowed God to take my hands and put a melody into the very atmosphere, I cannot but say, I can only say, the Spirit of the Lord has given me a song. He's given me a sound. He's given me a melody. He's given me a spirit that would hear the sounds of heaven that not many would know, because my spirit is seeking after the things of thee. So you know what? You're hearing things in your spirit. At times, you'll be in a meeting and you'll be caught away. It'll be a beautiful song. Have you ever been in that place? Just the melody, just the song. But there's something that's getting ready to transfer. God, it's like, you know, and I got to say this because I'm getting this. It's like a transmitter. God is transmitting things in your spirit, kind of like downloading things in your spirit. And you're going to have, but you're not just this. You're not just a drummer. You're not just a pianist. You're not just, what was the other thing, guitarist. There's a ministry for youth in you. There's a ministry for the young. There is. You say, oh God, I hate the youth. No, you don't. There's a ministry God's going to use you with drama. And you let God do that. Do you like drama? Oh my Lord, Daddy always has to come in on it, doesn't he? Is that your girlfriend next to you? Sit up, girlfriend. How are you? How old are you? 17. Yes. Remember, you're 19, she's 17. How many times have they told you this? I'm just talking what the Lord says. The Lord knows what you say in quiet. The Lord knows what goes on in quiet. God knows your heart. God's got a call upon your life. The hand of God's on his life. You got to be willing to pay that price with them, because whenever anybody walks with somebody and they date, they don't normally date in church, because you're usually getting ready to get married by the time you get to that place. And that's how I grew up. But I'm just saying there's a price to pay. It's all for Jesus. All for Jesus. You know? But the hand of God's in your life, and he's got a call on you. And you hate that, because you know why? You're a preacher's kid like I am. Hated it. Why can't I just have a life? I've got the best life in the world. I'm so glad my father taught me the ways and showed me the ways of heaven. It's wonderful. Are you finished school? What are you doing now? You do what full time? Well, if you want to go to Bible school, I have a scholarship. Change your life. Everybody should go to Rodney's for one semester. Just one semester. He'll teach you how to go into the middle of the Amazon and believe God. Most moving thing I've ever seen is my pastor's church. I've stayed on his property for 2 years and saw Bible school students walk in there with nothing. I've seen them walking in there, living in their cars, taking the shoes off their feet and putting them on the pulpit for offering. And I've seen them come out. So amazing. Somebody will just walk in the church, nobody even knows who the person is, be a millionaire. He'll look at about six or seven of the guys and he'll just take them out shopping and buy them brand new suits, brand new shoes. People just come in and just bless you from everywhere. You're like, what happened? You know, it's phenomenal. That's how it's supposed to be, isn't it? I'm almost done. Yeah, I'll pray for a few. Who else wants me to pray for them? Nobody. Good. Come up here. Come on. She's so lovely. This is Holly's mommy. She's such a good woman. And she's got a beautiful daughter and son-in-law. They are beautiful. They are. You've got treasured kids. The healing balm of Gilead goes through your body right now. The healing balm of Gilead, down your back, down your spine. The healing, come here. You got cancer. Oh, is she? Come on, Presta Dale. They tell her she's got cancer. You know, I pray for a woman stage 4 cancer, miraculously healed. All right, when did they tell you this? You look wonderful. You do. Pastor Dale, she said 19 treatments. It's a radiation. I believe you're my healer. And I believe you're more than enough for me. Father, I just thank you for, what's your name?
Janine.
Lord, I thank you for Janine. And I thank you, God, that nothing's too hard for you. Jesus, just right now, let the peace of heaven just wash over her. Just let the peace of heaven just wash over her. Let the peace that passes all understanding. Now, Lord, I thank you that as your peace just washes over her, that the blood of Jesus that was shed at Calvary, that right now every foul, tormenting spirit of infirmity, it bows its knee. Cancer goes. In Jesus' name, we speak to every lymph node to be made whole. I speak to the oxygen in her blood to be normal. I speak to rejuvenate, God, her very body right now. I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, for your healing anointing. Free in Jesus' name. Thank you for the healing anointing, the healing. Now, Lord, where do they say this is? Where are they trying to tell you it's at? Well, that's why God's healing your blood, didn't he? Say the blood. We talked about the blood. Lord, I thank you for going right now into the blood. Thank you for calcifying her bones. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Rabariana na na moriana na 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 mandara raboriana na 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 bosiana. Koriana na 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 bosiana na 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 bondiana na 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 bosiana. Shoriana na 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 yandara raboriana na 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 basi. Ina na na yandara niya. Healing of wonders, my King. Your blood that was shed at Calvary, every spirit of cancer right now dies at the root. Lord, you're the healer. You're the great I am. I ask for work. I thank you for working in miracles. I thank you for creative miracles. Lord, we're not letting go till I feel it. I know it. I know it. I know it. Lord, we're not letting go till I know it. Satan, you take your hands off of Janine. Thank you, Lord. I thank you. She doesn't belong to you. I thank you. The blood of Jesus flows through this body. Flows like water from Ruma Shabunda, Banda Bada, Bida Banda. Fire. Thank you. And Lord, I speak peace right now. I speak peace. I speak just a rest to come upon her. I bind every spirit of fear, any spirit of death, any lies the enemy would bring against her. And Lord, I speak that you go into her home right now. You go into that home. Lord, her son and her son-in-law and her daughter, they love you, Father. And God, you love them and you love this family. And I thank you, Lord, this attack, God, right now dies at the root. It dies at the root in Jesus' name. Lord, I break even the headaches off of her. I break the spirit of oppression that would come upon her. And I loose the working of miracles. I thank you, God, that, Lord, you put strength right now into her neck, into her muscles, into her back right now, that you give her new strength. I thank you, Lord, right now for healing this body. Free. Your grace, I'm nothing without you. Your grace. Jesus, let it go. There it is. Lord, we lay every hurt down right now. We lay every unforgiveness, every brokenness, every spirit of defeat right now goes. Satan, it goes. You have no rights. You have no rights over this woman. I command you to loose your hold right now. Fire. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Ooh, Shabunda, but there's the fire. There it is. It's starting to pour. There it is. I felt that. Oh, Rabanda, Satan, the anointing of heaven is falling all over her. The glory of the Lord, the glory of the Lord. More Shabunda, mighty visitation of your presence. Free. 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 Hallelujah. That's the presence of God. My goodness. Oh, Shabunda, Basianda, Rabasianda. Hallelujah, hallelujah. They told Carmen, same thing. And he was healed, totally healed. Same everything, melatonin, everything, totally healed. My pastor in Louisville, Kentucky, in Indiana, Greg Carter. Unbelievable. 49 people diagnosed with the same thing. And God totally miraculously healed him. I mean, he is so amazing, amazing. And here's Pastor Dale, amazing, amazing.
That's not been cleansed. That's what I heard.
Amen. When we speak healing, we break every effect of the radiation.
That's it.
Against
yes,
your body.
There it is.
Oh, yeah.
That's it.
Hallelujah. Isn't God good?
Turn around. See this guy right here? 15 years ago, they told him he had 6 weeks.
Oh.
For stage colon cancer. And he's still here. If he can do it for me, he'll do it for you.
Amen. Amen. Children. Now, what about you? Who do you belong to? How many kids you got? Yes. You're going through something. Come here, Blondie. You've been going through some stuff. You know what I mean? And there's just been an unsettling. The devil's trying to unsettle your whole world.
Can I stand up here with her?
Yeah.
She's my granddaughter-in-law.
She's been going through some stuff.
She's
God's just touching her right now. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you're not a God of defeat. And you heal the broken heart, God. And you see, God, Lord, the enemy came in and tried to bring a separation. But God, I ask that you restore what the cankerworm has stolen, God. That you restore this thing. And that you heal the brokenness of her heart, God. She's just broken, God, in two, God. Lord, that's not your desire. And thank you, Lord, right now for healing. For healing, give her the desires of her heart. Are you married? You are. Do you have children? First thing I thought when I looked at you, I thought, God, you're going to give them a baby, a bouncing baby. A bouncing baby.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to call that in. A little bouncing. I don't care if it's a boy. I feel like it's a boy, but we'll go with a boy or girl, okay? We're going to listen. I prophesied of Pastor Chuck Wyman's daughter-in-law. She would have a baby and she'd have twins and they'd be girls. You know, I did not know she had cancer, that she had everything done to her. And they told her she couldn't have children. And Pastor Chuck called me on the day I was getting on a plane to Ireland. And they found two heartbeats. And she babysits those twin girls now. They're 2 years old. I even walked in there the week before she's supposed to deliver. And I said, when are you supposed to deliver? She said, next Friday. I said, no, you're going to have them within 24 hours. Didn't I, Irene? And I laid hands on her. That D. Weimer was like, what is she praying when she prays? She had that baby that night. She had those twins that night. So come here. Give me that belly. Give me that womb. Father, I thank you for a bouncing baby boy. I thank you for a baby. Lord, I ask for a baby boy. If you want to give him a girl, you can, but I want a boy. I want a little boy. I thank you, God, that he'll have blonde hair like his mommy. I pray that's not bottle-fed hair. We just call blonde, curly hair into that baby. He'll be bald at first, but he'll have the hair. And I thank you that it's done in Jesus' name. A little, I don't know who Jedediah is, but a little Jedediah. In Jesus' name. Who's Jedediah? Do you know Jedediah? Is he a prophet in the Bible? What was he? I don't know. Oh, your name is not Jedediah, is it? Thank God. Well, a little J-name baby, okay? We don't have to name him Jedediah. Just don't name him the Jolly Big Giant. Father, I thank you. Joy, joy, joy. Give her this baby. I thank you for the baby. Thank you for the baby. I'm so excited about this baby. Thank you for it. Amen. Let me tell you something. You might laugh at me. I walked into my friend's Tom Jeffries church. His son walked in and his wife. I said, you're pregnant. You're going to have a baby. I got so excited. I told the whole church, they're pregnant. They're going to have a baby. They were freaked out. They were like so mad at me. I didn't know why they were mad at me. They looked at me like stunned. That was on Tuesday. That was on Sunday. Sunday night. Tuesday was Christmas. They call me Christmas Day. We are so mad at you. We had just found out we were pregnant, and we didn't want them to know. And you told the whole church we were pregnant. We were trying to wait till Christmas Day to tell them we were pregnant. And they had a baby girl, just like I said. They had a girl. I'm very, very big on babies. It's a wonder I'm not pregnant all the time. That's awesome. Don't you feel better? You don't? What's wrong with you? Shake off the blues. Shake off what's going on. Just say, devil, you know what you need to tell your situation? Is there nothing better than this you could deal with? Was there nothing else you can bring against me that was bigger than this? I get these men that argue with me, and I look at them, and I go, are you all the devil had to use today? Was there nothing else? You know, not you. You'll be okay. Are you studying? Are you in school? When did you graduate? You also did like those early teacher things. Yeah. Are you a nanny? Give her the baby in Jesus' name. She is married, right? Just thinking, just saying. Where's the son? Oh. New bride? You just got married? Well, that's not new. That's old. 8 months? 9 months? Hello? Get a grip here. Confirmation. 18 months. We'll have this baby. Hallelujah. And 9 more months. Well, you're not a prophet. You're having a prophetless moment. This church, whenever I've come to this church, it's like this church is fruitful and multiplies. Every time I come here, there's thousands of babies. I think you got things you put in the communion wine. Think fertility drugs or something. Isn't that wonderful? As long as I don't catch it, I'm happy for you all. What about you? You. Yes. You've only got two. How about you, Brother Hair? Look at your hair. It's just wild tonight. My God, is that the look? You didn't gel that, did you, or anything like that? Dear God. I'm just picking on you. You're not a doctor or anything like that, are you? Are you an engineer? Are you a painter? See, I'm being profitless right now. What's he do? What does he do? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? An estimator. I have a friend who does that stuff. Boy, isn't that great? And there's his sweet wife. We'll just, what, you got a boy and a girl? It's never good to stop at two. I stopped at two. I'm excited to be here tonight. I'm excited. I've been prophesying to Holly and to Michael. Maybe they need a little girl in Jesus' name. Brother Beard, you don't have to have nothing, Father Christmas. You're okay. And let me talk to the man up there, Mr. Sweater. Stand up, Mr. Sweater. The one who's sitting down. You know, you are a good man. You're a man of all trades. You'll do anything. You help everybody. You can take a brick. You know exactly the mortar. You know how to put it together. You know how to raise a wall. But there's something in you that you don't even know. And that is that God has put a call on your life. And that call is not about just standing behind a pulpit. But everything you do is a ministry. Everything you give is a ministry. And God says, don't ever underestimate your ministry that you have for my kingdom. Because that's what I've given you. Okay? Sometimes you need to be slapped. But you're okay. Have you been married twice or three times? Twice. I'm not your third wife, so don't look at me. There's not a man worthy of me out there. I'm just telling you, the hand of God's on your life. You got a son, no children, stepdaughters. Oh, Jesus. But I just see the hand of God's in your life, okay? I'm going to hand this to you, Pastor Dale, because I tell you, if I go around this room, I'd get Mr. Bald Man over there, Mr. Genie. How you doing, Brother Genie? Is that your lovely wife? She's beautiful. How long have you been married? Wow, that's the perfect number. That is. Stand up, both of you. I just want to speak blessing over your marriage. Because, you know, when you get to between the 7th and the 10th year, it gets a little bit difficult. You know what I mean? By the 10th year, we're ready to kick the bucket. It's the truth. I was there. Have you ever been there? You got to your 10th year. How did you feel?
I've been there 5 times.
But I just speak blessings over your marriage and blessings over everything that you do, that you will prosper. Blessings. How many children do you have? Enough. People are getting scared of me. They're getting scared of me. They drank the wine. Are they only girls? Oh, thank you, Jesus. But more than that, let me tell you something. Your heart's very sensitive. You're very sensitive. And I could see you, and it's like a wind came and it blew on you. And it's like a bruised reed. Every now and then, it's like just something just tries to come up out of you. You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, the hand of God's on your life. And God's a healer of even hurts that happened yesterday and defeats and disappointments. But God says, I'll never disappoint you, and I'll carry you. And I got my hand on you. Okay? Some things we just need to let go, because you know what? The things that happens to us when we're younger, or even with people that we really want to be our best friend, and then they just leave. And they leave us high and dry. And we're like, where are they? I don't understand why I'm telling you this, except to tell you that there were people around you that you really cared for and loved, and they're no longer in the picture. But God says, I'm in the picture, and I'll be your best friend, and I'll make things right for both of you, okay? Do you hear me? And then there's a healing. It causes things to fester sometimes in us, because we don't know what now. Don't speculate. You're in the right place. God's got you in this house. He's brought you to this church. Keep your eyes on Jesus and let God just do the work he needs to be done, okay? All right? God's not schizophrenic. He never changed his mind when he told you to come here. I'm just saying. So, Lord, I speak the blessings of the Lord over this whole congregation. I thank you, God, that this congregation is a ripe harvest congregation. That this congregation are harvesters, that they are people that take, they bring in the sheaves. I thank you, God, that the people here are learning in a new dimension, a new way, that, Lord, there's been some things that's changing, says the Lord. There's changing. And like a bridge over troubled waters, the Lord said, I made a way. And God says, I'm stirring things even now in people's hearts, and I'm showing you that I cause you to stand built by my spirit, not by men's, built by my thoughts, not by men's, built by my ways, not by men. So the Lord says, arise and flourish and be the tree that's planted by the waters, and know that my dew is upon your branches, and that I've never forsaken you and I've never walked away from you, but I'm doing a new work, that this house is in a new season, that things are getting ready to change, that even as the mill would turn the waters and the grain would come forth in the days of old, God says, think on this. I have allowed things that they would not even think of. I have given people the desires of their hearts, even though it wasn't what was needed. And now, says the Lord, look at the repercussion. But the Lord says, those who have known me have stood fast and waited. So the Lord says, those of you that have waited on me and said, we will wait upon the Lord, and he will show us great and mighty things. God says, this church is getting ready to see great and mighty things. Amen, amen, amen.
No idea what I'm talking about. Nothing. I don't know what I'm talking about. Thank you. Is that okay? You said I couldn't come unless I had a word for the church. Tell me I couldn't come unless I had a word for the church.
Well, I guess I'm just straightforward. That's the way it is. Yes. Praise God. Shall we? Aren't we glad? Come on, let's just... Praise the Lord. The Bible says, show honor to where honor is due. Praise God. Father, we just thank you for your graciousness. We thank you for sending Robin to us, Father, with a word in her mouth. And we pray, God, that you will bless her, Father, as she goes. Pray, God, that you'll strengthen her, keep her healthy, we pray, in the powerful name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen, amen. Amen. See you all on Sunday.